Good morning. Thanks for joining me on the Meg Ellison Show. My guest this morning, Rachel Verveldi. She is the Senior Director of Workforce Education and Employment Policy for WMC, Wisconsin Manufacturers and Commerce. Woo! I don't know how all that fits on her business card, but she's on the phone with me nonetheless. Good morning, Rachel. How are you?
Good morning, Meg. I'm good. How are you?
Good, thank you. And, you know, I'm reading your biography, and I'd forgotten this about you, is that you were Congressman Glenn Grothman's chief of staff. And
So were you
located in Washington, D.C.?
Yes, I lived out there for just under 7 years.
Oh.
Loved working for the congressman. He's a great guy.
Isn't he? Love him.
Yes, but I'm very happy to come back home and be back in some reality here, unlike D.C.
Right. Well, please tell me you're not located in... you are in Dane County. I just see that you're in Sun Prairie. Sorry, that maybe that's too much information to divulge. But, I mean, I think I do appreciate conservatives, you know, taking one for the team and sticking it out in places like Dane County, because I know that that Republican Party in Dane County is very active, and they are motivated and inspirational to me.
They are, yes. And I'm on the edge of Dane County. And my parents are in Columbia, so I sneak out every now and then. So.
Yeah, it's a good way to put it, on the edge. Because I think that's how I'd feel if I were in Dane County, too. But so let's talk about this new survey that the WMC put out. And it was a survey of Wisconsin businesses and their attitude about the Wisconsin public schools.
Yeah, we survey our members about twice a year, asking them questions about public policy and also economic questions as well. And this year, we've heard from so many of our employers that, you know, they were starting to see some significant problems with their employees unable to do basic skills. We decided to ask some education questions. And we heard from these employers that we surveyed that 73% of them believe that students graduating from Wisconsin's public K-12 education system are unprepared for the workforce. And it was shocking in some ways, but it's not shocking because we do know that, you know, 2/3 of our kids are unable to read at grade level, and 60% of them are unable to do math at grade level. So we are now starting to see this in the workforce, and employers are very concerned.
And it's interesting how there's this movement on the left to oppose school choice, despite the fact that that is now, well, it's actually more, there are more options thanks to the Republican legislature. But it's interesting that those on the left would be opposed to ensuring that every single school child in the state of Wisconsin receives the best education, the individualized plan for each student. And it's amazing to me that anyone would be opposed to wanting to ensure that a child gets what he or she needs in order to be successful when they become an adult.
Absolutely. It's so disappointing that Democrats are so opposed to school choice and to charter too. You know, I do want to put a plug in and thank Republican leadership for pushing for investments in school choice and charter. I mean, they really pushed for that and got that across Governor Evers' desk. So we really thank them for that, because we are seeing really positive results with kids that are able to go to choice and charter schools. They have better outcomes, and employers really feel that they're more prepared for the workforce when they go to these schools. Plus, these schools are more willing to work with employers. You know, there are some great public schools out there that are working with their employers, but so many of them are resistant to form that connection. And choice and charter are being really innovative and working with the employers and talking with their students about opportunities after school. Things like, you know, going straight into the workforce or getting an apprenticeship or getting some credential rather than just going into a 4-year degree.
You know, it'd be interesting to follow up in a few years, perhaps, or I don't know if you could do it now, but to determine among your membership who has employees that were part of a choice school program or a charter school, and determine, you know, compare the employee from a charter that had a charter school education or a choice school education and a student that had a K through 12 public school education, and see if there are marked differences in the way in which they excel or don't excel in their jobs.
Yes, I believe that we'll see a difference, and I think that's a great point. That'd be great to hear from employers if they're seeing that as well. I mean, another question that we asked in our survey is asking our members if they have any employees who struggle with the ability to read or do math, and 56% of them said that they have employees who struggle. And, these are basic skills. These are things that are the very least that students should be learning in K through 12 system, is reading and math and writing. And that's what employers are saying their employees are struggling with currently.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think about, I'm sure you've had this experience too. You're at a store, and as opposed to getting 97 cents in change, you give the cashier 3 pennies and say, here, and then, you can give me a dollar back, as opposed to having to get that number, that much change back. And it oftentimes perplexes them. They can't do the math in their head. And it's, something as simple as that I think is indicative of the problems in our public school system.
Absolutely. Yeah, I've had that happen to me as well. But, we've also heard stories from our members about how their employees are struggling. And there's this one story that really sticks out to me that I would like to share with you and your listeners. That we had a manufacturer say they had this great employee who showed up on time, who worked really well with others, which I will say is something that many employers say their employees struggle with. So they thought, great, we have this great worker who we're going to have for a while. He loved the company. And all of a sudden, he came in to the office and quit. And they couldn't get him to say why he quit. And they finally convinced him to stay on. He was there for another couple weeks, came back in the office and quit again. And they talked to him. And finally, they got him to admit that he couldn't read the safety manual that they had given him to look at, and the machine instruction manual that they had told him that he needed to read in order to do his job. And he was so embarrassed that he couldn't read that he just decided, I'm just going to quit and look for a different job because I don't want to admit that I can't read. And now this employer stepped up and said, you know what? We are happy to get you up to reading level. And they hired a tutor for him. Now he's reading. He's been promoted since now, and he's doing great at the company. But this is real life experiences that employers are having to deal with, and having to spend significant dollars for training and education for their students that should be done in the K-12 system. And how sad for this gentleman too, that he went his whole life until he admitted this to his employer, unable to read.
Well, and what's tragic about it is that we're finding example after example throughout our country of public schools that are not focusing on the basics. And I mean, Tony Evers himself said that there's a phonics plan that was just a phonics. I'm gonna grab my notes here so I get this correct, because I had a guest on just this morning and we talked about it. And there's a literacy bill that was signed by Governor Evers, and it's a phonics-based phonics-centric literacy. And Governor Evers himself said, well, reading is only a small part of a child's education. And I would argue that if you can't read, the rest of the education doesn't even matter.
Exactly. We know from research that if a student is unable to read at grade level by grade 3, they're going to be behind for the rest of their life, because all of their learning after grade 3 is based on reading. And so it's just so disappointing to hear him say statements like that, and to just not understand the gravity of the situation that we are in currently.
Well, and I mean, I guess the challenge for employers is actually finding employees to begin with, let alone qualified employees. And you'd think, I mean, I guess you'd take it for granted, or at least I did until I heard the results of the survey, that that at the very least, an employee should be able to read and do basic math. And I was sharing with you off air that I just got back from vacation. My husband and I spent a week up north. And the number, and it's, I mean, it's the same down here too, but, and throughout the state of Wisconsin, is that a number of businesses up in the North Woods are struggling to find employees. And, you know, let alone, again, qualified employees. And I think that they're willing, here's an example, is there was a restaurant that we actually talked with the owner. My husband and I had dinner there, and we talked with the owner. And I mean, he was essentially one of very few employees, and he was working every hour that the restaurant was open because he struggled to find a cook to actually, well, you know, you need a cook to have a restaurant. And he struggled with it, and he'd shared with us that he had just hired a cook, and he was hoping that, first of all, the person would show up, and secondly, that the person would work out, and you know, they'd have an opportunity to provide better service to their customers as a result. But I mean, the challenge of finding employees, let alone qualified in the most basic sense, is really, it's frightening to the future of Wisconsin and Wisconsin business.
Absolutely. And we asked in our survey how many of our employers were struggling to find employees. And 75% of them said that they're still struggling to find employees. And then we followed up and asked them, well, have you reduced your hiring requirements in order to get more job applicants? And 63% have even reduced their hiring requirements, you know, either the amount of experience needed or the level of education. And they're still struggling to find people. And that's going to have impacts. I've talked to many of our members who've said that they need to expand their business. They have the orders, they have the need to expand, but they're not even looking at Wisconsin for expansion because, one, there's not people here to do the job, or they're sitting on the sideline instead of working, or two, they don't have the education necessary, and by education I mean basic skills, in order to do jobs here.
Yeah,
so we're having significant problems, and we're losing out on economic expansion because they're having to go to other states because of the lack of workers.
Well, it's got to be frustrating for an employer that really wants to expand their business. And, you know, I guess I asked this question, and I presume that you might have an answer to it with regard to WMC's membership. I mean, are there Democrat business owners that can see the light on this and that are willing to acknowledge that these are problems that are easily resolved if those on the opposite, the left side of the aisle, would acknowledge that they're problems and that they need to be focused more on the basics in order to ensure that we have an educated, you know, at the bare minimum, an educated workforce?
More and more employers are stepping up and talking about this because it's become such a big issue for them. I think you're seeing it, employers across all political spectrums talking about it and pushing the legislators to have real reform. I think that's why you're seeing, such support among employers for school choice, for charter. I mean, 89% of our employers in the survey said that they support investing additional money into school choice and charter schools. And then we asked, you know, additional funding for apprenticeships and dual enrollment and work-based learning opportunities. 99% of our employers surveyed said that they support doing that. So you're seeing employers from across all political spectrums uniting behind these issues and really starting to reach out to the legislators and say, this is important to us. We need to make sure that kids are having the right opportunities, being able to go to the school that fits their needs, and then they're also being exposed to work-based learning, career-based learning opportunities, getting hands-on experience in employers near their schools or, you know, in the surrounding area so that they understand, one, the skills that are needed when they graduate, and then two, they're also being exposed to opportunities that they may not even know exist in their local communities.
So do you talk with Milwaukee area business owners that acknowledge that the choice program, school choice program, particularly in Milwaukee, is successful and necessary in order for adults to succeed after they've gone through a school choice program?
Yes. The employers in Milwaukee view school choice program as vitally important. I mean, the Milwaukee public school system is just failing their kids. There's huge racial achievement gaps there. And the employers are very concerned. They know that the kids that are graduating from high school are completely unprepared. I mean, they don't have hard skills, but they also don't have soft skills. And they're feeling like the only option for them is choice and charter. So they're huge supporters. Employers, I should say, in Milwaukee are not just supporters locally, but they're also giving to these schools as well. They view it as so vitally important to the future of their companies that they're investing their dollars into a lot of these school systems, both charter and choice, in order to make sure that they're able to stay afloat and to keep educating children.
Gosh, speaking of educating, every election time, I'm always thinking about how we can ensure that the low information voter has more information about the candidates from which to choose. And, you know, it's Democrat policies that are harming our business community, that are really harming our way of life in Wisconsin. And I had a guest on this morning, Quentin Claiborne from the Institute for Reforming Government. And we talked about the literacy bill and in particular how in Milwaukee, these Democrat policies where they kept the schools shut down for so long sent the message to not only children, but to the parents, school children, but to their parents, that school wasn't necessary because they were not in session, in person. And so many of these kids never return to the in-person school because of the policies that Democrats implemented during what I call the shamdemic.
Absolutely. We saw a significant problem coming out of the pandemic, particularly in the school districts that stayed shut down longer. But I will be honest, you know, we started to see problems even before the pandemic. Our scores started plummeting years even before that, but it was just made even worse by the pandemic. And you're absolutely right. It was the message that came across to parents and students is that school is not necessary. And K-12 school is vitally important to employers, making sure that these students are up to snuff and up to the ability to do math and writing and ability to read. These are so vital skills for employees when they enter into the workforce.
Well, and I think that the shamdemic just illuminated the problems in the public school, and I think made more people aware that the agenda isn't about the education of children in Wisconsin, but it's about the indoctrination of children and this far left woke agenda, which certainly doesn't help. Maybe it helps them become a protester as a potential job, but it certainly doesn't make them prepared for the workforce when they graduate, if they graduate from high school and move on.
Yes, you're absolutely right. I will say, in some ways, as you mentioned, the pandemic was good for education because it woke parents up. And I honestly do not think we would have had significant investments that we had in choice and charter if parents wouldn't have woken up during the pandemic and saw what their schools were teaching their kids or what they weren't teaching their kids. And I think that has helped us as an education movement be able to make significant progress in this state.
Holding those who have bad policies accountable is always a good thing. So Well, Rachel Verveldi, thank you so much for joining me this morning. I appreciate your time, as always, and all your work on behalf of WMC. Please stay in touch and look forward to chatting with you again.
Thanks so much, Meg.